Hi, I'm Joan Neuberger, and today we're talking with Erika Bsumek. Hi, Erika.
Hi, Joan.
Erika is a specialist in Native American history and Western history of the United States. And this month we're featuring her book, Indian Maid, Navajo Culture in the Marketplace, 1868 to 1940. In the book, Erika, you tell a story about the commercialization of Navajo crafts, weaving and silversmithing, that looks very different from all the different participants' point of view, particularly the Navajo Indians and the European Americans who commercialized and marketed their crafts. Do you want to start just by talking about that?
Yeah, I think one of the things that I wanted to do in the book was there had been a lot of literature written about the history of weaving or the history of silversmithing in terms of how the craft developed or the materials used. But what I really wanted to do was sort of place the materials that were being produced within a larger historical framework in terms of different time periods and how things changed over times and from different perspectives. So the perspective of the people who produced the goods, the perspective of the people who were selling the goods, the perspective of the people who were buying or collecting the goods, and you know, what kind of picture do we get about this world that the Navajos are inhabiting as we're sort of moving from the 19th into the 20th century? What kind of world are they inhabiting, and how is their life being changed by sort of modern contemporary consumerist trends?
Mm-hmm. And one of the things I like best about the book is that there are contradictions and paradoxes on every side. It's not just that the Navajos saw things differently than the white traders, but even the Navajos themselves had what looked to us like contradictory views. And one of the people who really exemplifies that is the silversmith Miguelito.
Yeah, Miguelito.
Do you want to talk about him and his role early in his life and late in his life?
Sure. Miguelito is an interesting individual. He was actually, in addition to being a silversmith, he was also a sort of medicine man, a holy man among the Navajo. And he was also a wage laborer. So Miguelito sort of assumes these different roles or combines all these roles in his own persona. So early in his life and career, Miguelito goes to work for one of the big retailers, an individual named Fred Harvey, who started a string of hotel chains along the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe Railway line. And he works there as a storeroom clerk. He's also a silversmith. His wife is a weaver. And so he really sort of embodies, you know, all these different roles that individuals have tended to see Navajos in individually, but not sort of combined. So he really sort of, you know, represents what a lot of people see as contradictory, you know, that you could be a traditional spiritual leader and a sort of modern wage laborer. Mm-hmm. So I think Miguelito is kind of interesting on those terms.
Mm-hmm. And he really revered his own knowledge as a medicine man and the value of the secrets, I guess, of traditional healing. But late in his life, he was willing to share some of those in the hotel he worked. How did that work?
Well, so Miguelito, I think what you're referring to is the sand paintings,
yes,
right?
Yeah.
So sand paintings traditionally were wholly, was sort of a ceremonial art viewed, conducted only during ceremonial times, traditionally ceremonial times, and meant to be a temporary construction, a temporary sort of form of art or expression of spirituality. So they would
temporary put, in the sense that they
right. They would put the sand down, make the sand painting, and then it would be sort of either destroyed by nature or sort of swept away. Mm-hmm. And you know, Americans are fascinated by this art form, by this sort of religious art form. And what they convince, what Fred Harvey, the sort of same individual I mentioned before, convinces Miguelito to do is to put up one of these large sand paintings in one of his hotel called the El Navajo Hotel in Gallup. And for Miguelito, it becomes sort of a quandary. To what extent does he merge his sort of traditional culture with this sort of modern market culture? And he ultimately decides to do it in part because the company sort of makes him an offer he can't refuse. They offer him to pay him, but he also sort of decides that it can be done in a sort of non-spiritual way, that it can be sort of, that consumer, that Americans should be able to see it, to appreciate the Navajo and their art forms, their various art forms and their spirituality. And so Miguelito does it, and then he, you know, people on the reservation, the Navajo on the reservation are really upset that he's sort of, puts up this sort of visual image of the sand painting in the hotel. And they're really remarkable. The sand paintings are really remarkable.
Are they still there?
The El Navajo Hotel was destroyed, and the sand painting, I don't know what happened to it, but sand painting now is sold to American consumers on the reservation. It's one of the things that you can buy, sort of these smaller versions of Yabiche or Navajo holy figures. So Miguelito kind of starts a new market, a new consumer trend by engaging in this, something that creates a new revenue stream for the Indians, and something that's popular among consumers because it represents something.
Yeah, it's a great example of the contradictions. He's revealing secret knowledge, but in order to share his culture and get appreciation for it, and also to make money.
Right.
And he's proud of himself in all these different ways, and yet there are all these contradictions.
And the white world is sort of appreciating the sort of Navajo spiritual world, or the spiritual world of the Navajo, which is very different from, you know, the BIA is trying to send Indians to school and eradicate their religion.
The
Bureau of Indian Affairs is, you know, simultaneously taking the children away from the reservation, cutting their hair, teaching them to speak English, eradicating their culture. And so, you know, Miguelito's kind of trying to walk this line where he can, you know, promote that appreciation.
And yet, a lot of what the traders did was enforce an idea of primitivism on the Indians. How did that come about?
Right. So this is that.
I think this is a marketing strategy.
Yeah, as a marketing strategy. I think this is one of the sort of key contradictions in the book, and it's a complete fabrication to a certain extent. That the Navajo do have a sort of ancient knowledge, or you know, a traditional knowledge base, but they also integrated over the course of time new technologies and new fabrics, new dyes into their world, into their new animals, all those things into their world. And one of the things that the traders do when they realize that there is this potential market, that white consumers are interested in Indians and want to buy the things that Indians make, you know, one of the things that they do is they really craft their image. So, you know, by 1868, the Navajo have been released by the federal government from Fort Sumner. They were considered savage. They were considered enemies of the federal government. The government had interned them. In 1868, they're let go. The government sends them back to the reservation. The traders end up there. They try to tap into this market, and they realize nobody wants to buy goods from, you know, these sort of savage heathens, but they do want to buy goods from this sort of traditional primitive population. And so they craft that image of the Navajo as being primitive, as being pastoral, very carefully in order to sell the goods. So on one and part of that means that the Navajo have this sort of unchanging tradition, and that's one of the things that they promote. But if you look at what the Navajo are doing, right, they had been fighting the government, they had been integrating new technologies, and they continue to do so even as the traders are crafting a completely different image of them. And that's the image that really becomes the mainstay of the Navajo, the weavers and the silversmiths especially, into the, you know, mid to late 20th century.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about the trading posts where this all began. To me, and I'm sure to many listeners or viewers, the word trading post has a kind of romantic connotation. Yeah. And yet, like the Navajos themselves, they were modernizing and they were entering into the modern capitalist marketplace.
Right.
How did the European-American traders come to dominate the Navajo market for goods?
Well, you know, part of that is they become the kind of cultural brokers on the reservation who deal with whites off the reservation, both in terms of the corporations like the Fred Harvey Company or the dealers and traders across the United States. So they become the sort of middlemen in between, you know, they become the distribution hub in essence. And, but, you know, shortly after the Navajo are released from their internment, the traders, these Europeans go out to the reservation, not knowing that that's going to be their role, what they really think they're going to do is they're going to trade with the Indians and make a profit from trading with the Indians. And they think, you know, they'll sell sheep or they'll sell goods to the Indians. But, you know, as that occurs, they also begin to sell the products that the Navajos make from the sheep, or, you know, the wool gets turned into the blankets have a market due to this sort of promotional campaign that the Fred Harvey Company starts and then the traders tap into. So the traders begin to dominate the sort of distribution chain on the reservation, and then they dominate the economy of the reservation because that's one of the few places that Navajos can go and shop and get the modern goods that they want. Mm-hmm. So their territory has been limited. They can't farm the way they used to farm. They can't live exclusively off of the sheep herding that they had traditionally maintained. So they need to buy modern consumer goods, canned goods, foods, etc. And the traders begin to sort of trap them more or less on the reservation by the Bureau of Indian Affairs gives the Indians money, but the traders pay the Indians in scrip that can only be used on their own trading posts, individual trading posts.
You mean when they buy their silver and rugs?
Right. So that, you know, either they get sort of government payouts, or when the traders buy the goods that the Navajos are bringing in, the sheep, the blankets, the silver work, they pay them in scrip, right, that says Hubble Trading Post or, you know, sort of the various trading posts. And so they try to sort of monopolize the trade of specific groups of Indians. And that's how they come to dominate the you know, both the sort of exchanges with the outside world and the exchanges internally on the reservation. And that's why they get such a bad reputation. Mm-hmm. But they sort of allied that by promoting the more romantic aspects of we trade with the Indians and we live this primitive lifestyle and the Indians are completely separate from the modern market economy. Meanwhile, they are selling them Singer sewing machines, but they don't promote that.
So whites come to dominate the economy and they come to define what Navajos are as a sort of tradition-bound people. How did Navajos themselves see their role in using the trading posts or using the trade?
Well, the Navajos are really, despite the fact that traders are trying to promote this idea that they are primitive people and that they're divorced from the modern market economy, the Navajos are really savvy American consumers, and they learn pretty quickly that they can play the traders off of each other in terms of negotiating for price. The distance is the one thing that makes that more difficult because the trading posts are sort of fairly far apart. Mm-hmm. But they both begin to sort of realize that the traders are as dependent on them as they are dependent on the traders. And so they say, in essence, there are letters, there's correspondence from the Navajos to the traders saying, in essence, you know, when you need blankets, I make blankets for you for the outside market. Now I need goods, you need to give me the goods that I need on loan, in essence, right? You're gonna, you know, so the next time I'll bring you blankets. So they begin to really manipulate the marketplace as best they can in terms of, you know, not, they don't have the upper hand, the traders have the upper hand, but they really attempt to move to the to their ability on the reservation.
And moving into the 20th century, these trading posts eventually reach out to department stores and begin selling Indian goods in large markets, and they become consumer items, and they become mass produced.
Right.
So, how do they become major consumer? How do they become part of sort of the American middle class domestic?
That's a great question. That's a great question. So part of that has, again, to do with Fred Harvey, who uses the goods in the interiors of his hotel to sort of promote a particular aesthetic. And part of it is that there's sort of a fad for things primitive by the 1920s that has kind of swept the United States. So goods from Africa or goods from Polynesia, or, you know, sort of wood carvings and goods made by primitive people is sort of sweeping the nation. And then you have here domestically in the United States, these traders who are promoting the Indians as primitive people. And at the same time, we get this sort of modernist art aesthetic, which is very sort of bold, geometric designs, kind of promoted by people like Picasso.
Which and itself was based on what they considered primitive African art.
Exactly. And so, you know, the Navajo goods really sort of fit into this aesthetic very nicely, and middle-class consumers, instead of getting, for instance, Oriental rugs that also kind of fit to less, you know, more or less within this aesthetic, which are expensive because they're imported from further away, they look to the Navajo traders, and the traders say, hey, we're here and we can meet this need. And so they have the Indians begin to weave rugs that look a little bit like the Oriental rugs, but still have those bold geometric designs. And modern consumers, you know, want to celebrate the sort of more American aspects of the art form by the Indian goods. They associate it with the American West. They associate it with travel and adventure and this new American tradition. And so, so you know, stores like Bloomingdale's eventually tap into it, or Macy's, and they coordinate with the traders to buy these goods in sort of large numbers to sell them from their stores. Mm-hmm. And so we get Indian rug centers in the bottom, in the sort of interior design sections of these department stores.
And then when demand increases, mm-hmm. Production changes,
yeah.
and mass production comes in. And one of the really interesting parts of your book is how the government begins to want to regulate and define what Indian made means. And how does that change this relationship?
Well, I mean, that brings up a contradiction. So the government is interesting in that regard, because there are sort of two government agencies who are involved in the mass production of the goods. And on the one hand, you have the Bureau of Indian Affairs, who is attempting to assimilate and modernize Indians. And so within the Indian boarding schools, they're teaching Indians how to use machines, lathes, sort of heavy machinery. And the Indians can use that in the production of their goods. And on the other hand, you have the Federal Trade Commission, who wants to ensure that consumers are getting exactly what they think they're getting. Mm-hmm. So we have the government who's involved in two different ways, one in promoting assimilation and the other in regulation. And at the same time...
And the regulators want to ensure that consumers are getting Indian-made goods that are somehow traditional,
right,
rather than...
that are handmade, that aren't made with any added additional machinery, right, with any modern technologies, is the way that the government, is the way that the Federal Trade Commission puts it. And then you have outside interests who are trying to take advantage of this trend, and so they're completely machine-producing the goods, either the jewelry or the rugs, mm-hmm. right? And so in order to protect consumers from goods that are being mass produced, the Federal Trade Commission steps in and they say, you know, goods can only be made by hand by Indians. Well, at this sort of key moment, we have traders on the reservation who are helping Indians make the goods with machinery, mm-hmm. right? And the question becomes, can these individuals help Indians make goods with the use of machinery, or can they integrate this technology they're learning at the BIA schools mm-hmm. Into the production of their goods? And so we get this sort
and
of debate.
Still call it authentic.
Right, or Indian made, right? Uh-huh. The label is, can it be called Indian made?
Lots of contradictions yeah. in defining what authentic yeah. is.
Right, right. or and what traditional
I would
is.
Guess that consumers also wanted cheaper goods, and that pushed the mass production at the same time.
Right, so the key court case that I look at in the book is about that. You know, consumers who want cheaper goods, but they also want handmade goods. And so we have a dealer in Albuquerque who sets up shop across from the Fred Harvey Hotel, the big Hotel Alvarado, where these goods are being produced and consumed, handmade by Indians. And he has Indians use machinery in his shop on a sort of assembly production line. But since they're Indians who are making the goods, he feels he can still call these goods Indian made. It's the height of the Great Depression. He can sell the goods for less because the production is being streamlined. And the court steps in and says, you can't do that, because consumers associate the Indian made label with handmade traditional labor on the reservation. And essentially what you've done is you've demonstrated that Indians are sort of part of this modern marketplace, and that's not what consumers think. So in order to protect consumers, not Indians, the FTC rules that Indian made sort of conjures up a specific formula and can only be made according to these sort of, according to Navajo tradition. Mm-hmm. And the Navajo say, but we've always integrated new technology. That's part of our tradition. Mm-hmm. We want to be paid the wages. It's the Great Depression. We can make money. And the court says no.
Mm-hmm. That's a great example, I think, of how history is just much more complicated than we often see it. Or even the way that we often write it. We try and categorize things. We try and come up with pigeonholes to explain things. But really, it's very complicated.
Yeah, it defies categorization, you know, what is traditional, what is authentic, what is handmade, you know, what is machine made. All of these things get sort of, the lines are blurred between all these different categories.
Yeah.
But the one thing I will say is, you know, that weaving sort of is a little bit different in terms of these traditions. So I'm really primarily talking about silversmithing. But when the court passes that ruling, what they do is sort of codify a certain set of production methods on the reservation that now really have helped Indians and Indian producers, because their goods are associated with a specific kind of quality, and they can charge a lot more for those goods. Mm-hmm. So it's really kind of helped preserve that you know, a specific kind of craft on the reservation.
Is there any one individual in your research who really captured your imagination?
There are a number of different people that I could talk about, but I think that the one person who kind of sparked a lot of the different parts of the project for me was a woman named Grace Nicholson, who hailed from Philadelphia, ended up in Los Angeles, and was sort of an adventurous soul. And so she became fascinated with Indians, traveled to a bunch of different Indian reservations, collected goods, sold them out of her home in Pasadena. And then, you know, so she's got this little house where she's selling to middle-class consumers. And she sort of perpetuates a lot of the ideas about Indians, but also taps into a kind of pent-up consumer demand that women especially have, where women aren't, a lot of women, their husbands won't let them have bank accounts, or they won't let them travel freely. And so she helps them invest in products that she thinks are going to accrue value, namely these Indian goods. And she says, look, the Indians are all going to die, and, you know, these products are going to be really rare one day. And so, you know, you can invest your money in traditional ways, but you can invest them in home decoration or artifacts that are going to assume value. So she sort of is able to sort of manipulate this, the sort of limitations of middle-class women at the time period in order to grow her own market. She travels for them. She writes them letters about where she gets the goods, and the goods become associated both with investment and adventure for the individuals who are buying them. Mm-hmm. So I thought she was a pretty fascinating individual. And her house now is a large museum in Pasadena. Uh-huh. She actually builds a large museum in Pasadena.
Well, thank you, Erika.
Thank you.
Very interesting. Thanks.
Thanks, Jill.